Almighty God, in you are hidden all of the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word, and give us grace that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Now, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." And he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. Word of God, wisdom of God. Thanks be to God.
Our second scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. You can find it on page 44 of your New Testament. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them up high on the mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared with him Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, is it good for us to be here? Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for he was terrified. When the cloud overshadowed them, from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one anymore with them, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one what they had seen until after the Son of Man has risen from the dead. Word of God, wisdom of God. Would you pray with me? Holy One, help us to see you in a new way today. Bless us, we pray. Be with the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, that they may be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Transfiguration Sunday. Did you know that? Surprise! Transfiguration Sunday. This is a kind of a cool Sunday. It happens right before Lent. Every year, we have the celebration of the Transfiguration, which I just read to you. You're familiar?
Yes.
Good, you've heard that story. What about the first story?
Yes?
Yep. Are you familiar with that one too? Awesome. So, I want to talk a little bit about Elijah. Man, dyslexia is hard. And I already told Andy when I saw the scriptures, I was like, I'm sorry. But I want to talk a little bit about Elijah this morning before we kind of talk about the Transfiguration, because it's important. Are you familiar with him as a character? I mean, I'm sure you've heard of Elijah.
Yes,
I've talked about him some already this season. Do you understand that he is a rock star of the faith? Yes. He is like the prophet. If there was ever a prophet to be a prophet, he's the man. So I want to give you a little bit of a concept. If I was to put this in modern language for you. You are the last Christian on earth. All the rest of the Christians have either disappeared, gone into hiding, or quit the faith. They have all taken the churches, every other Christian has taken the churches that were built and started worshiping other gods, and those other gods' sole purpose is to find you, the last Christian, and kill you. That is where Elijah's story starts with the Jewish faith. He is the last Jew. He is the last one that's not in hiding, the last proclaimed prophet, the last one that speaks with and for God. And yet, brings back the Jewish faith, converts the Jewish people again back to God, starts the lineage of prophets, beats down theologically the other God worshipers, and brings back the faith. That's the guy we're talking about. Okay? He's kind of a big deal. Yes? With me. Okay. So Moses, you've heard of that guy. Yes? So Moses represents the one who saves the Jewish people. Moses takes the Jewish people out of Egypt. He walks up in front of Pharaoh, does the whole deal, speaks with God directly, delivers the people out of Egypt, guides them all the way through the wilderness for 40 years, so a whole generation and a half. So a whole new generation of people, of Jewish people, have followed Moses. So when Jesus shows up on the mountaintop, Jewish people, the person who saved the Jewish faith, and the person who will save the world. Yes? This is really cool. Now, it's no surprise that the disciples are a little overwhelmed. Remember how a few weeks ago we talked about God would not come and preach in the cloud anymore? Yes? That they were too terrified by that? This is the only other time God shows up in a cloud on top of a mountain from that point on.
Yeah.
God shows up in the cloud and says, they have a powwow, Elijah, Moses, and Jesus, powwowing in the cloud, which Moses is very accustomed to. And then the voice says to the disciples, not to the three, but to the disciples, "This is my son, listen to him." And the cloud disappears, and Jesus is standing there, alone. This is cool. Yes? I think this story is fascinating and beautiful.
Yeah.
So what does this have to do with us? Why do we talk about this? Why do we do it every year? We have a Transfiguration Sunday. It's magic, she said.
Magic.
This is one of those fun, magical stories in faith. So I happen to have somebody who's also pretty well studied in scripture that lives in my house. So sometimes we happen to be preaching on the same things, like on big Sundays, like this one in particular. So all week, it's been, what do you think the point of the Transfiguration is?
Well, I don't know, what do you think the point of the Transfiguration is?
Well, we had a good discussion. And I like where Dan's at, but you know, if you want to hear his version, go over there. But I think for me, this time, because we read the story I read the story every year. This year, what stood out to me is that the breaking of death. I know I gave you a bunch of history, and now I'm going to kind of go back to my point, the point I want to make. Elisha doesn't die, really. He doesn't really die. He gets abducted by a chariot and a whirlwind. Moses doesn't really die either. We actually have Moses' body. They bury him. But it's kind of, the whole thing is very shrouded in weirdness. The language of it is not clear whether he just left and they made a tomb for him or whether he actually died. It's very odd. Then you have the only other figure in scripture who has a not death death, which would be Christ. So for me, I wonder this round, as I've been thinking about it, if part of the point of the Transfiguration is to show the disciples not only the connection, I think the connection between these three people is vital to this story. But I wonder if this is actually a prelude. Christ all along in Mark is saying to them, when I am resurrected from the dead, when I am resurrected from the dead. And they're like, yeah, 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 gotcha. But I think in this moment, God is trying to make the point that this death thing really doesn't have power over my people. You with me? This whole thing, I mean, we as humans, death, who's afraid of death? It's okay to say that, right? I love it. A lot of people, 100% of Americans will die. Yeah, I say that all the time.
And pay taxes.
Yeah, I say that to hospice people, and they like look at me like shocked. Like a room full of, you're all gonna die. Sorry. That's part of it. But this story is one of the times in which we're shown before the cross that this man, something is going to happen with this man. He goes from this story very quickly in Mark, from this moment into Jerusalem towards his death. So the secret that I think is happening here is that this is really going to happen. All along in Mark's gospel, whenever anybody starts to figure out who Jesus is, Jesus shushes them. We refer to it as the messianic secret, the secret that he is the Messiah, all along in Mark's gospel. And so as we're going along, you've been given the clue. You've been told in this Sunday, as we get ready to head towards the cross, that this is about the weirdness of this man's death, but that he is connected. He is part of God's people historically, and he's above them. God says, "This is my son." He doesn't say that about Elisha and Moses. He says, "This is my son." This one stands above those that saved you as a people, those that saved you as a faith. This is bigger than that. God says, "I'm not going to show up like that to the whole people," but shows up in the cloud. Historically, I mean, we're supposed to remember that God showed up talking to Moses. That's the point of the storytelling here. It's supposed to bring back all of those memories so that we know this guy has something to teach us. And what are we told? To listen to him and don't say anything. Anybody good at keeping secrets? I know some kids that aren't good at keeping secrets. So let's work on this Lent, listening to him as God instructed us on the mountain that day. Amen?
Amen.